You're okay?
I'm okay. I don't know about that one, but I know these are fine. That one glares.
Okay.
Behind you. Yeah, that's the only one. The rest of them are okay.
Okay. Y'all, those of you who are watching us on Facebook, we're still adjusting to the changes. Our show shall be weak and it's an adventure. So, okay. So I got down to verse 3. In chapter 21. Let me see if I can find it here in this. Okay. Where I got to find my place. You should have been doing that. Okay. All right, here we go. Revelation 22:3. It's about, y'all found it? Okay. Just before the section called in Jerusalem. Verse 2. And there shall be no more curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. And his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face. And his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there. And they need no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever. So we, in the realm of the Spirit, and in the presence of the Lord, there is no more curse. Book of Galatians, it's been broken. By faith, the Holy Spirit, and the blood of Jesus, it's not automatic. But we have to appropriate it. So we who are living in eternal things are already walking in the realm of the Spirit of no more curse. And you have the authority to break curses off of your family, generational curses, sins of the fathers and grandfathers, and those curses do go down. But not for a Christian. A Christian is in Christ, in the realm of the Spirit, there is no more covenant, no more curse. But the throne of God and of the Lamb shall be in it. The throne of God and the Lamb are in you. And his servants shall serve him. And they shall see his face. And his name shall be in their foreheads. And there shall be no night there. And they need no candle, neither light of the sun. For the Lord God gives them light, and they shall reign forever and ever. I didn't pull up the message that I have for no more night. We may run into it somewhere in our study here. But the Lord woke me up in the middle of the night. Oh, I don't know when, ever, years ago. Stood me straight up in bed, and he said, Carolyn, preach on the song, No More Night. And of course, at that point, I had to do some, there is a song, No More Night. But also, he was talking about the song in the book of Revelation, No More Night. Because in that realm of the Spirit, there is no more night, no more pain, never crying again, for we are living in the light of the risen Lamb. We actually live there. In the presence of the Lord, there is no more curse, only blessings for those saints who will abide in Jesus. I read the scripture this morning. When we're sowing into the kingdom of God and into the love of God, it is the law of God that we have already attained his righteousness, we own it, and that we live in the liberality of his everything. So that is work up. As we sow into the kingdom of God. But we have to claim it, just like there's no more curse. Okay, but we have to claim it. You know, Before the advent of the divine judge in chapter 20, verse 11, where we study the great white throne judgment, there was no longer any sea. The sea was to the Jews a symbol of separation, not as to the Greeks. A means of communication. And throughout the Holy Bible, it symbolized restless insubordination. That which is metaphorical of restless insubordination. Okay, New Jerusalem. 21:2-4. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them, and be their God." Okay, this is a fact. We have inside of us God, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus. We are the temple of the Holy Ghost. The tabernacle of God is now with men. The tabernacle of God is now with us. "And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." Okay, July 28th, 1992. I told y'all I was going to go back to vision that God gave me, and I'm sure you've heard me preach on this. Since we're preaching the book of Revelation, there's one Bible to preach, and we keep preaching it. Okay, the Lord spoke to me to teach metaphorical language. And this is one of the languages of God, which is used throughout the Bible, especially in prophecy. A metaphor is a figure of speech in which one thing is spoken of as if for another. And those people who are literalists will never understand that the Bible is written. Much of the prophetic language is written in metaphorical language. The Bible is full of parables, types, prototypes, symbols, fables, allegories, metaphors, and idioms. And those all have to be interpreted as to what their meaning is. Okay, so God told me, what he said was, "Carolyn, teach on metaphorical language." You see how God, you have to figure out what God's telling you to do. You can't just, you know, what did that mean? So I began to pray, where to teach. Should I teach Psalms, the major prophets, the minor prophets, what? I soon got that answer. The Lord spoke to me, teach from the book of Revelation. Later, the Lord gave me a vision of the night and showed me New Jerusalem. The vision of New Jerusalem. I was on a high place and saw the city at a far distance. The buildings of the city were white as pearl, and the streets of the city were pure gold. It seems to be flowing like a river. I saw that it was a walled city, but that was the only detail I was shown, except a roof line of the city was sculptured golden domes. The Lord spoke to me in the vision. He said, "Carolyn, teach New Jerusalem as purity." And when he said that to me, my whole concept of the book of Revelation changed. "Carolyn, teach New Jerusalem as purity." Ezekiel 43:1-12. "Son of man, describe the temple to the people of Israel, that they may be ashamed of their sins. Let them consider the plan, and if they are ashamed of all they have done, make known to them the design of the temple, its arrangements, its exit. follow its regulations. This is the law of the temple. All the surrounding area on top of the mountain must be most holy. Such is the law of the temple. So the Old Testament temple is Ezekiel, is metaphorical of the gospel church and of New Jerusalem. The vision of Ezekiel's temple begins in chapter 40, and these chapters deal with the temple and God's glorious house. And this section emphasizes the permanence of the glory of the Lord. His book, Ezekiel's book, begins with the vision of God's glory in chapter 1 and concludes with the same in Ezekiel 1:28. This was the appearance of the likeness of the glory of the Lord as Ezekiel described the four living creatures. So in Ezekiel we see a new temple and a new worship and a new appointment. The dimensions in Ezekiel's temple are much greater than Mount Moriah. It's larger than Jerusalem or Canaan. There is a stream from the temple all the way to the Dead Sea. This teaching was a follow-up of a previous teaching of the brazen altar. In that teaching, I covered the eight temples of God. To understand the temple of New Jerusalem, I will briefly recap the temples of the Bible. God created man for one reason. God longs to have fellowship with man. God chose us. God's first dwelling place with man was in the garden. And they heard the voice of the Lord walking in the garden in the cool of the day. The God who made man and placed him in the garden was the God who came down to that man, walked with him, and talked to him. Then sin separated man from God. But we know that God walked with Eve, talked to Abraham, and spoke to Moses face to face. Then God spoke to Moses, saying, "Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them." There is no suggestion that Moses proposed to God. It was God's idea, God's desire. This temple was a portable, temporary dwelling place. The Lord said there, "I will meet with you, and I will commune with you." Then God gave his consent at the request of David to build a permanent temple. But not to David, because he was a man of war, but to his son, Solomon. With great magnificence and with tremendous costliness, he built the temple. And on the great day of dedication, the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. Then man's sin of idolatry angered God, and God allowed the destroyer, manifest in Nebuchadnezzar, to destroy the temple. After 70 years, there was a return of the people to Jerusalem, under the leadership and anointings of Ezra and Nehemiah. Zerubbabel's temple was then built. This temple was modest compared to Solomon's. But the people gave the best they had for the construction materials. Always give God the best you have. It doesn't have to be the best there is, but give him the best. God accepted it and dwelt in it. And the children of Israel kept the dedication of this house of God with joy. And we should too. We should know that when we are in this house that is dedicated to God, that we should keep it with joy, that we are to be in awe of God, and we are to honor it as a dwelling place. And the next temple to be built dealt with Herod's temple. There is no indication that this temple was built in the will of God. Herod tore down Zerubbabel's temple and constructed the new temple for the perpetuation of his name. Herod was a builder and he rebuilt much of Jerusalem. God again provided his own temple. Men could not keep the law and God's covenants, so God had already made provision from the foundation of the earth for a new and better way, to fellowship with man. God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them. And Jesus said, destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it. Thank you for the anointing, Lord. Each temple was short-lived. The temple of Christ's body was destroyed when they nailed it to a tree. And when Jesus rose from the dead and ascended into heaven, and the Holy Spirit of God descended upon the disciples, another temple came into being. Know you not that you are the temple of God, and the Spirit of God dwells in you? For you are the temple of the living God, as God said, I will dwell in them and walk in them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. People, God, we live so far below our provision that God has already made for us. He has given us everything he did in his word. But we have to step up and claim it, walk in it like we own it, and like we know who we are in Christ Jesus. God has again come very near to man. And because this temple, our earthly bodies, our flesh bodies, is not eternal. God made a way through grace that the dominion of death was destroyed by the death conqueror for those who have been brought from death to life. Our spirit man will live eternally in heaven with Christ Jesus. No more death. No more tears. Never crying again, because we are living in the life of the risen Lamb. Now, we have already started living in that. We don't have to wait till we die to live in that life. We are, because he is in us, because he has chosen to live in us, the Father lives in us. He has tabernacled in us. His temple in us. We are already walking and living in that realm. Amen. The eighth temple, described in the Word of God, is a spiritual temple. For we know if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. So our house is eternal. Now, you and I are already walking in eternity. Yes. We live in this world, but we're not part of this world system. Ezekiel saw the spiritual temple and visions of God, beginning with chapter 40. He found metaphorically the fullness of the gospel temple erected by Christ and his apostles. And under the types and figures of a city, temple, altar, priest, and sacrifice, greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made, that is to say, not part of this creation. I believe for those whom God has saved and called to a holy life for his own purposes and by his grace, I believe he will raise up a church triumphant on this side of heaven that will experience the glory of the Lord in all its fullness. That is my life quest, to see God do that, because I believe it. That is my faith. You know, he showed me the book, Faith is a Fact, Hope is a Certainty, and Love is a Reality. Okay, my fact of faith is that God is going to raise up this glorious church and that we're going to live as heaven on earth.
Hallelujah.
And for my hope, that's a certainty. Hallelujah.
Yes, hallelujah.
But it's not automatic. And it probably will be for everyone. Well, I know it won't. If they don't receive Jesus Christ, you can't get there. The only way we can get into this realm of the Spirit is through the blood of Jesus Christ. Mm-hmm. And it must be received by faith in the blood of Jesus Christ. That's the only entrance, that's the only door to go through.
Yes.
Son of man, this is Ezekiel 43:7-9. Son of man, this is the place of my throne and the place of the soles of my feet. This is where I will lie among the Israelites, true or spiritual. I added that forever. I think at the time I wrote this in 1992, there was a big argument over true Israel and spiritual Israel. Okay. Look, I'm an Israelite, all right? Because I've got the blood of Jesus in me.
Yes.
Okay. The house of Israel will never again defile my holy name, neither they nor their kings, by their prostitution and the lifeless idols of their kings in high places. I will live among them forever. Any view of restoring animal sacrifice in Israel is a direct insult to the words of Jesus in John 4:13-14, and the clear teaching of Hebrews that his sacrifice was once for all and never, never to be repeated.
Amen. Thank you.
For those of you watching, the Spirit of God just rolled across this room. John 4:13. The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and you say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour comes when you shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. You worship, you know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. And as Israel is fighting right now against the very gates of hell and Satan itself, upon the Jews is a forever blessing. Salvation is of the Jews. That is a forever blessing. Because Jesus was a Jew. And the Jews, except for Luke, wrote the whole Bible. And the apostles were all Jews. The hour comes, and now it is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeks such to worship him. True worshipers shall worship the Father to that. Now, the only way we can come to you and worship him is in truth. And the only way we can walk in truth is that we have our hearts spread open before God and say, here I am, just clean me up. But the Father seeks such to worship him. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. A lying spirit believes his lies. We can't worship God in a lying spirit. God is building a new temple. We are living stones put together, fused together without sound of a hammer, without man-made religious systems trying to organize us, which makes me think of the community organizer. See, he doesn't even have a job in the kingdom of God. Community organizer has no position in the kingdom of God. A game system trying to organize us. Brought together by the spirit body into a relationship and unity which only God can do. This is God work, not work of community organizer. Only God can bring together his people.
Yes.
Now, people have systems and agendas and they work, and I thank God for gatherers, bringing them in, and we do have to gather them in. But it's only God that brings us together by his Spirit and holds us together by his Spirit. This is the temple that Ezekiel saw. This is the temple that has a river running out of it. A river of life, clear as crystal. John and Al Agnes saw it. Ezekiel saw it. Isaiah saw it. And I saw it. You also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. And God brings us together as lively stones. And as you've heard me say so often, the lively stones smooth each other off. And God brings us together for that purpose. To this point, we see the complete exclusion of man from the design of the temple. Man is incapable of determining the standards of divine holiness, as described to Ezekiel. Its entire design was a caricature of the holiness and perfection of God. Okay, so Carolyn, teach New Jerusalem is purity. The glory of the Lord returned by the way of the east. His voice was like the voice of many waters, and the earth shined with his glory. The Lord Jesus, God's glory, was brought to the temple to the circumcised and dead people. Luke 1-2. And Jesus was circumcised and dead people. Another copy of his heavenly tabernacle is described to us here in Revelation 21 as the is thus emphasized that the church is the city whose architect and builder is God, not a voluntary association of men and women who are community organizers. I don't have that written in. Very, more than I ever really gave him credit for. walk in Holy Spirit truth. The Holy Spirit is the truth, is truth, is not the truth. And he that sweareth in the earth shall swear by the God of truth. Because the former troubles are forgotten, and because they are hid from our eyes. Revelation 21, 7 through 8. Now, we have been preaching from 3 through 6 up to this point. And so what he's, in verse 7, he's saying, he who overcomes will inherit all this. And I will be his God and he will be my son. But the cowardly, the unbelieving, the vile, the murderers, the sexually immoral, those who practice magic arts, the idolaters, and all liars, their place will be in the fiery lake of burning sulfur. This is the second death. John's catalog, as I said, I was preaching earlier, we don't want to go through that second death. Okay. We're going to be with that crowd we don't even have to go with the great white throne judgment. No, we're going to already be in heaven with the Lord. Okay? John's catalog of those who are excluded from the blessings of the new creation begins with those who through fear have denied the faith in face of persecution. He who overcomes will inherit all this, and I will be his God, and he will be my son. But the coward. And faith is, fear is opposite of faith. Through fear. The vision of Holy Jerusalem was delivered by one of the seven angels who was the messenger of the gospel to the apostle. The angel said, come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb, and he carried me away in the spirit to a mountain, great and high. This is the spiritual mountain of vision to which all prophets will be brought, I believe, my persuasion. Ezekiel described it in Ezekiel 40, verse 2. In visions of God, he took me to the land of Israel and set me on a very high mountain, on whose south side were buildings that looked like a city. John describes it in Revelation 21. And showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. It shone with the glory of God, and its brilliance was like that of a very precious jewel, like jasper, clear as crystal. John ransacks the resources of language and metaphor, jewels, golds, and pearls, to describe the indescribable glory which the holy city reflects. Isaiah 60, verse 18. No longer will violence be heard in your land, nor ruin or destruction within your borders. But you will call your walls salvation and your gates praise. That's a spiritual temple. Spiritual city. Ezekiel 43:1. Then the man brought me to the gate facing east, and I saw the glory of the God of Israel coming from the east. His voice was like the roar of rushing waters. And the land was radiant with his glory. And God named us. It had a great and high wall with 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates. The wall is our security. The city has a wall that is impregnable as well as precious. The guards to the gates of the city are 12 angels to admit and receive the redeemed. Since God called us the East Gate, now we're not the only East Gate, okay, of God, because the East Gate is inside of us. Because we're the temple, so the East Gate is inside of us. Okay? Doesn't that make sense to everybody? It does to me. So we're not the only East Gate that the glory of God is going to come through. And I wouldn't certainly help y'all say that I say that, because I know that God has many that he's going to bring his glory through. But I also know that no matter what comes our way or what we have to walk through, God has never taken his presence from us. And that we are to hold that gate. I believe everything. If that is true, what I believe, then we have an angel for the East Gate. We have many angels that belong to this church. I have seen the lampstand burning. We have praise and worship angels. You have a pastor's angel. Pastors have a special angel that God made my pastor. But we have I believe we have an East Gate angel. Because the Bible says that there are 12 gates and 12 angels at the gates. But I believe we're just part of the East Gate. Meaning, who are we to be one of the gates? The guards to the gates in the city are 12 angels to admit and receive the redeemed. Isaiah 60:11. These gates will always stand open. They will never be shut, day or night. On these gates were written the names of the 12 tribes of Israel. The beloved city is thus marked out as the true Israel, our people of God. This is emphasized by the reoccurrence of the number 12 and its multiples. 12 is metaphorical of the number of the elect are chosen. The 12 gates of pearl, Revelation 21:21. The date that I have on here that I last taught this is December 2nd, 2007. As I went through this today, and we're going to get down to that point, I noticed that I made a mistake on the gates when I was going through this. Y'all remember that Dan is going down to the gates of New Jerusalem. Manasseh is in there instead. And for some reason, I put Dan in here when I was describing the spiritual meaning of each gate. Each gate. So probably what I'm going to do is when I get down to that place, I'm going to go back and make an adjustment on those gates. I believe what I wrote about the gates is true and exact. But I need to replace Dan with Manasseh to make this totally accurate. And I'm sure I was taking it from the gates of the Old Testament and their alignment. But they were realigned even in the New Jerusalem. Yes. In the Old Testament, the first gate is Reuben. Yes. In Jerusalem, in the New Jerusalem, set out time. Okay. New Jerusalem 2022 is prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. Revelation 21:9b. Come here, I will show you the bride, the Lamb's wife, having the glory of God, and her light was like a stone most precious, even like a jasper stone, clear as crystal, and had a wall great and high, and had 12 gates. And at the gates 12 angels, and names written thereon, which are the names of the 12 tribes of the children of Israel. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls. Every several gate was of one pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were transparent glass. The Lord is speaking to John in the oracle language. And this is one of the languages of God. Very often God will speak to prophets in their oracle language. He used to speak to me in it a lot more than he does now. But what he did, when he speak to me, then I have to go back and figure out what he said to me. Because he will be interpreted in the Bible. Whether he has used a temple, a city, the bride, the sons of God, the tabernacle, all of these images are used to describe a people in whom dwells the fullness of God. This is the body of Christ, the Lamb's wife, the church in glory and perfection. This is God's dwelling place among men, and there's no need of a separate temple. If the Lord is there, the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are his temple. In the present gospel order, the temple, city, and commonwealth are all in that dwelling place in which God lives by his Spirit. And Mount Zion is forever the presence of the Lord is. The 12 gates, and I'm just going to barely touch on it because it's almost time and I want to close off. And then I'll come back to it next week. But the 12 gates equal 12 experiences which do progressively unfold from the Christ. The God, our divine nature from within us. 1 Corinthians 3:9 through 10. We are laborers together with God. For you are God's husbandry. You are God's building. According to the grace of God which is given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, another builds thereon. But let every man take heed how he builds thereon. 12 gates are 12 entrances into the light of the gospel church. There are no shadows. 21:27. There shall in no wise enter into it anything that defiles, either whatsoever works abomination, nor makes a lie, of which are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Verse 8. And I had read this earlier, but wanted to read it again. The fearful and unbelieving, and the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars, shall have their part in the lake which burns with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations to it. When I first came to the pasture of Little White Church, I named it Glory Lane. First day I was there. The light of this glory of this gospel church is prophesied by Isaiah, Jeremiah, and Zechariah. There is to be no shadows, but only substance and reality. to spiritual experience that causes us to experience the gate under the gaze of the 12 tribes of Israel. I'm giving you seven. Four go. Okay. Let me check. Behold, a son. This gate speaks of the experience of the new birth, which is the impartation and deposit of the very nature of God. This is the seed of life of the divine nature. This emphasizes the ministry of the Holy Ghost as fullness of his nature. Joseph equal Jesus, our elder brother. He shall have another son. Whoops. I'm on the wrong one. I got elder two. Sorry. He draws an individual and brings him to the place of repentance and faith. This marks the beginning of our salvation, the beginning of the descent of New Jerusalem into the visible realm. And that'll be how we'll cover the gates of how it applies to our journey. And then we're going to go into the 12 precious stones. And I kind of went over that a little bit with Tammy, because God had shown her each one of the stones in New Jerusalem had a prophetic meaning. And the first stone on the breastplate goes back to the breastplate of the priest, to the 12 stones that ties in with the breastplate of the priest. And the first stone on the breastplate is Judah. The stone is Sardis, a blood red or wine stone. Judah means praise of Jehovah. This is the sixth stone in the foundation of New Jerusalem. To have the characteristics of Judah means to have Christ dwelling within the heart in all fullness. Judah, you are he whom your brethren shall praise. Your hand shall be at the neck of your enemies, and your father's children shall bow down before you. Praise will always be blessing in its train. The scepter is from Judah, the anointing of authority, and so on. So we'll get into the 12 stones and the 12 gates as we continue in this. Good night. So I'm going to leave this right here and not think about me. And let's see, I'm going to put it underneath all of this. And we'll start there in 2 weeks. How's that? Questions?
What was the band headed?
Judas was from the tribe of Dan. The people say, I mean, that's what the old time theologians who were historical. But you know, I was reading in Matthew, last chapter of Matthew this week, and Judas repented.
Judas?
Yeah, he repented. The Bible says that he
threw the money back.
Huh?
He threw back the money.
Well, yeah, but he was sorrowful and he regretted, I think, what was the words, the exact words there. Yeah. What he had done. Mm. Look at the last chapter of Matthew, something that said. And then he went back and he threw the coins and it became a potter's field. But then he went and hung himself. But he actually did repent in great remorse for what he had done. I'm sure I knew that. You know, I'm sure I don't forget things, but maybe. more questions?
Also, you mentioned God's will in us was longing. This is my word. Return to the original situation.
Which is what God wanted.
Especially if we access it.
Yes. When he wants his fellowship with us.
Yes.
That's why he dwelled in the garden and he wanted fellowship. That's why he came. That's why he keeps building these temples, is because he wanted fellowship with man.
Yes.
He wants a relationship with us. And so what he did was, he just came in and dwelt us.
I'm sure that was hard for people at that time to comprehend.
It's hard for people nowadays to comprehend.
We always think about it in the natural and not in the spiritual realm.
Yes, yes.
When we think about God coming and dwelling in us, we think about it in a natural flesh sense as opposed to a spiritual thing.
God is spirit.
Yes.
And that was the worship given to us, worship given to spirit. I had a vision one time, and I'm not sure I should share this on Sunday night, because I'm studying the river to remember of it. I've never quite figured it out, but that's okay. I don't have to figure things out. But I saw, like, the spirit, this big, I guess, shaped like a man, if he had a face. But he was spirit. And he was holding me like I was a baby in his hands. That's how he got close. He wants to be with us. He wants to have a relationship with us. He wants to spend time with us. He wants us to spend time with him. Any more questions?
Well, one thing that does strike me is the beauty of the temple, with the pearls and the stones and the foundation, just everything about the temple. It's just everything is magnificent. Everything is beautiful. There's nothing there.
And it's often a reflection of the beauty of Christ.
Yes. Yes.
And the beauty of his body. Because we are part of New Jerusalem. We're already part of it.
It talks about us being living stones, as we say, if we sharpen like that, we bring out, I believe he brings out the beauty in us as we yield to him, but if we don't, then his glory doesn't come to us.
We're not polished.
Yeah.
He said, Carolyn, teach metaphorical language. If he thought you're meditating, it's not time for you to back up. Just because of it. have your heart scheme beside it. If you ate your power thing, you don't know what he tells you to do, you're going to miss out on it anyway.
Right.
You're not going to receive it. Standing right there, he didn't know what's going on. Standing at the altar. But we stay focused now. Obama almost knocked us out. We quit praying for the nation. We took our thing we had. Pray about you.
Hello, Eastgate. We love you. Gloria Scott.
Hi, Gloria.
Yes, amen. Gracie Vanner. Sophia's on. Ann Price is on. Josh is on. Valerie is on. Pat Lee. And Julie Woodall, Marcella, Lily, and Ann. And Ann Price sends her love.